how do we do those things that reduce inequality in our society and broaden opportunity? And government can't solve all of that, but government can't stand on the sidelines when we're doing that. And without some faith in our capacity for collective action, those trends are going to get worse. So we've got to, and young people in particular, have to understand government is us. Government's not somebody else. Government's us. We have the capacity to change it. Voters have the capacity to change it. Members of Congress do, as well as the president.
That was President Obama in an interview with my MSNBC colleague, Chris Matthews, explaining that government is not the other, government is us. And that's a fundamentally different view than that held by many conservatives, especially those with a libertarian bent. Listen to Senator Rand Paul in Detroit yesterday, explaining his proposed economic freedom zones that he says would jumpstart sluggish local economies.
Economic freedom zones will remove government obstacles to success. They'll provide a generation of citizens, students, workers, and job creators with a new bargain. Your government will get out of the way. It will treat you like an adult.
Joel, is the thing that we mostly need is for our government to get out of the way?
No. If we did, there would be no public roads or public sidewalks for Senator Paul to even get to that event. The problem is that we've replaced opportunity capitalism with crony capitalism. Look, my grandparents came here with the hope that they could build a better life for themselves and their grandchildren. And they knew if they worked hard and played by the rules, by and large, they could get ahead. The real engine of economic opportunity is hope, and we've demolished hope in America, and we have less upward mobility than virtually every one of our serious economic competitors.
Look, that point, Ovid, just feels hard to deny that we are not the country that we once were, that we have a American myth about economic mobility, that economic mobility has dissipated, and it has dissipated at the same time that corporate profits have increased dramatically. Why would we need more corporate profiteering, lower taxes, and less government investment?
So I think also there's a consensus position around the fact that the government should be involved in building roads and post offices. Nobody's objecting to that, right?
Well, some of the libertarians are.
No, I mean, not really. I mean, like, if the only thing the government did was build highways, I think libertarians like Rand Paul would be very happy, right? But that's not the only thing the government does. That's a fraction of the federal
budget.
That's
why we can't get a transportation bill passed. I mean, the reason is that traditionally, I think he's correct in this sense. That's traditionally been the position, I think, of a lot of mainstream conservatives. I think, but what I've seen is a departure from the idea that we held in this country, that it was a combination of government and the private sector, not government versus, government against. And we had a debate about the degree, the extent, the roles, the responsibilities. I see a different kind of debate where either the government is all friend or all foe, or the private sector is all friend and all foe. And I just tend to reject, you know, that point of view, because that point of view is not the kind of point of view that helped us achieve a greater degree of economic mobility, a greater degree of income equality in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, as your chart mentioned.
So, Ovid, is there a better balance then, this point, that there can be some balance between that conversation? Because it does feel like Paul is suggesting this massive disinvestment of the government.
I think even Rand Paul would agree that economic mobility is the priority. The question is, again, what policies will achieve economic mobility? So, and this is one thing that, to your point, I think Republican intellectuals and Republican thought leaders have long talked about the need to improve the degree to which that is the priority of Republicans. The Republican base is less passionate about that sometimes, and that's sometimes a tension between how the GOP advances these issues. But having said that, certainly among the leadership of the Republicans, among conservatives, you read National Review, you read the Wall Street Journal, there's a lot of talk about what we can do for education, for example, where we see from the conservative point of view that there's a tension in the progressive movement between teachers' unions and poor children, school choice. The Obama administration is fighting school choice in Louisiana.
Oh, no, they're not. Come on now. You know, this is one of the places where my president and I deeply disagree, in part because they really are much more conservative than progressive. The Obama administration's education policies have not bolstered public education for the most part. They have mostly been voucher-based policies or charter schools-based policies or what we think of as school choice policies. But that said, if we look at, I just want to not miss what it is that Rand Paul was suggesting with these economic freedom zones, right? This significant decrease in taxes and a, like basically spaces, zip codes, where people can do business without even a minimum wage. How is a lower minimum wage better for Detroit?
Economic freedom zone. It's not a new idea. It's a new twist on an old idea.
Okay,
Jack Kemp had enterprise zones. Bill Clinton had empowerment zones. This is a new twist on an old idea.
All right, so stick with me. We're going to stay on this question of the old ideas and new ideas and whether or not we really are a better country than this, because coming up next, the movement demanding better jobs is growing exponentially, even as the unemployment numbers are falling dramatically. We're going to talk more also to Amy about these fast food workers debates. There is, as always, more Nerdland at the top of the hour.